Welcome back, and welcome to Module 4, where we're going to talk about performance. Now, Bob, you know, you've worked with SQL Server a long time. Can you tell us a little bit more about the history of SQL Server and Azure SQL and performance?
Yeah, sure, Anna. You know, performance is one of those interesting areas of SQL Server and Azure SQL. You know, this is the second in our series of the meat and potatoes. Remember, security was kind of that first thing, and performance is a second, not necessarily in the different order, in the same order, or the order doesn't necessarily matter. It's just an important part of meat and potatoes. And then our third one is going to be availability in the next module. But performance has some interesting characteristics I've seen over my career at Microsoft, and that is performance is usually hard to get right, and it's hard to keep right, and to just, you know, make sure you're always staying on top of performance for your application. And SQL Server over the years have provided so many great functionalities to help you do all of those things. But also, performance has this interesting characteristic about problems. You know, no one defines a performance problem very specifically. It's usually very vague, like it's slow, or I don't know how fast it is, or it's changed in speed. And so I think it's going to be interesting as we look at this module about the topics we built for you to understand in Azure SQL, just like SQL Server. What are the capabilities? What kind of tasks you need to do? How do you configure it? How to maintain it? How do you monitor it? And then what are those scenarios? Everybody likes to think in things in terms of scenarios, and we'll certainly do that in this module. Talk about what are the key performance scenarios for Azure SQL that feel like a little about SQL Server. And then what I really love is we're going to kind of go bigger at the end of the module to talk about how can you do things that are really neat in the cloud, you know, to help you tune that performance, accelerate it, and then even some really cool intelligent performance capabilities.
So when we look at performance, you know, Bob, what really stands out to you?
Well, if you kind of look at this slide right here we built, again, like security, we're going to talk about the capabilities of performance for Azure SQL, and then what are the common tasks you need to do to configure and maintain and keep performance well for your application and database. But just look at this list on the left. You know, these are things you struggle with and you deal with SQL Server, and it's the same thing you're going to be dealing with Azure SQL. A lot of times it's exactly the same and sometimes slightly different because you're using the cloud, and we're going to get into all those things. But look at the tasks. Those are the same things you're always doing with a SQL Server deployment. And it's really cool because we're going to show you, really get into the details of what is the same, what is different, and then even where does the cloud kind of give you some more capabilities or even save you some time, you know, that you're not used to. So Anna, let me dive into some of these capabilities and kind of compare them from a SQL perspective. So first of all, when you think about capacities, when you're deploying SQL Server, you care and have to think about CPU, memory, how big my database is. And we did in those in our early modules, we talked about the different options you get for those kind of capacities and limits. But consider a couple things here. Like Azure SQL Database, if you didn't think it was possible, you can go deploy an Azure SQL Database and get up to 128 vCores, 4 terabytes of memory, and 4 terabytes of database space. That's going to meet a lot of demands for the performance needs of many different SQL deployments out there today. You need something bigger than 8 terabytes, which you can get actually in one of our deployment options. Here's your choice. It's hyperscale. Hyperscale is going to support a maximum of 100 terabytes and unlimited transaction log space. So you really need a big deployment database size-wise. Hyperscale is going to give that to you. And in that managed instance, you are going to get a SQL Server instance capability, but with these kind of type sizes I'm showing on the screen here. So just getting the right capacities early on, we talked about pre-deployment, we talked about your options during deployment, are going to be important. But even as we showed you during deployment and configuration in a previous module, you can change some of this. So if you don't get it quite right, maybe you need to scale up or down what you're doing. You know, we do have options for you to do that as well. The thing about indexes, we support everything you need for indexes. Everything you do in SQL Server today for indexes are going to be there for you. And in case, in almost every tier we have things like column store indexes available to you. Now, in-room OLTP has been a functionality we've shipped for several releases of SQL Server. It's for those really high-speed, low-latency transaction environments. And that is available in our business critical tier offerings. And we even going to, you know, pre-create a memory optimized file group for you, and we're going to give you limits on how much memory you're going to get as part of your overall memory limit for what we call hecaton memory in SQL Server. So you just look at these capabilities right here. It's lining up very much how you do things in SQL Server, tailored to how you're going to configure and deploy in the cloud. Partitions are something that's been used for a lot of different years for SQL Server applications to take large tables and partition them to maximize performance and manageability. You do get partition capabilities. A lot of people I've read out there said you don't get that with Azure, but you do get that with Azure. The difference is you're not going to be placing file groups with partitions in Azure database, but you can do that in a managed instance environment. And then maybe a lot of you have seen me over the last few years talking about SQL 19 performance enhancements like intelligent query processing. A lot of that functionality is there in Azure SQL. Not every single thing we've done in 19, we're slowly and surely getting those capabilities into the cloud, but things like intelligent query processing are available to you in Azure SQL. In fact, that's an example of something that started in Azure first and then came down to SQL Server. So, you know, Anna, if I think about all these things together, you know, we've got the capabilities I think you need to deploy SQL Server in the cloud. And in several different cases, it's going to be tailored specifically to how you would use the cloud.
Thanks, Bob. It's really interesting to see some of the capabilities that are both in SQL Server and have made it to Azure SQL, as well as kind of the other way around. In the next videos, we'll dive deeper into how these tasks relate to some of the capabilities. See you in the next video.